brought to you in partnership with the Dyad Institute. You. More.
With the popularity of TV shows like Orphan Black, the idea of human cloning is hot on the brains of everyone and their sister, and their sister, and their other sister, and their other sister, and their brother. But thanks to modern advancements in genetics and synthetic biology, we might have the power to manipulate the human genome in ways that could let us engineer ourselves or our offspring to be free of disease, even to have customized traits. But could actual human clones really exist? Well,
hey, Dyad sent me. They want me to, like, co-host this episode with you or something. Okay. Gotta do what the sponsor says, I guess. You look really, never mind. So yeah, clones could exist. They already do. We call them identical twins. Identical twins are the result of a single fertilization. Like, one sperm, one egg, it splits into two embryos. So they start out with the same genetic material, but even identical twins aren't, like, totally identical. In early development, they get hundreds, maybe thousands of random mutations in every cell of their body that their twin won't share. And no matter what movies want you to think, identical twins have different personalities, and they don't even always look completely alike. Even two genes that are the same, letter for letter, can act differently thanks to signals in the DNA molecule itself. It's epigenetics, and it's how genetically identical organisms can turn out very differently. This continues for their whole lives. Genetic changes adding up in different cells of the body. We're not even genetically identical to ourselves, man. Speaking of clones, I was just shopping at my local organic farm-to-table market, and I ran into some clones there, like this avocado, this apple, an orange, even this banana. Actually, pretty much all the fruits and veggies we buy are genetically identical clones. Scientists have also been working to make cloned animals by taking the DNA out of an unfertilized egg, replacing it with the DNA of an adult animal, the whole nucleus. Now there's even talk of bringing back some extinct animals, like big woolly mammoths. Researchers have already done this with several living animals, including Dolly the sheep, some dogs, even a cute little kitty named Cece, a carbon copy. Aw, I would have named the cat Felix myself, but that's just my opinion. Because of mutations and epigenetics, just like twins, those cloned animals are slightly different than their genetic parents, or siblings, or however that works out. I mean, they might be clones, but they're individuals, right? How much difference does it take to be yourself? Good question. Thanks. You know, it goes beyond cloning. This stuff might be able to save lives. Now that the human genome has been sequenced, we've identified genetic variants that increase the risk of certain diseases like breast cancer. We've also zeroed in on genes that influence more superficial things like eye color. Change those DNA sequences in a sperm or an egg, and you could make designer babies with customized genes, and they'll even pass those changes on to their offspring. We currently have the technology to do just that with gene editing tools like CRISPRs, where a short piece of RNA guides a sort of molecular pair of scissors to snip a particular DNA sequence, letting us change any sequence in any organism at will. They're easy to make, and it's been done lots of other times in other animals. And we don't even have to modify the DNA in the nucleus. Some rare diseases are caused by mutations in mitochondrial DNA. Fertilized eggs can have their mitochondria swapped out for mitochondria from a donor that doesn't carry that mutation, and then they're implanted in the mother. This so-called three-parent in vitro fertilization was recently made legal in the United Kingdom, but it's still outlawed in most of the world. Excuse me. Who do those genomes belong to? I'm asking for a friend. Well, as of now in the United States, naturally occurring DNA can't be patented. Like that gene variant for the breast cancer gene BRCA1, that's already found in nature. Nobody can own that. But synthetic genes, DNA that we custom make, which we can also do, well, those belong to whoever makes them. Someone should put like barcodes on those or something so they know who the DNA belongs to. They could probably actually do that. Synthesizing DNA is really cheap and easy. In fact, we can already do most of this stuff in humans. Cloning, designer genetics, at least in theory. But while we're willing to test these technologies on plants, sheep, rats, dogs, they're off limits in people. We don't completely know how they work.
It's sort of like a futuristic chicken and the egg problem. In order to know if these technologies are truly safe for people, if their benefits outweigh their risks, we'll need to do some amount of human testing, or at least testing on human cells. But until we know how safe they really are, most people have declared that it's too risky or even unethical to do that testing. What do you think? Do technologies like cloning and human genome modification represent a bright new future or a dark and scary one? What should we be worried about? Or is it all good in the name of progress? Let me or us know in the comments or on Twitter. Are you guys on Twitter?
What up, everybody? I'm here for the shooting. What? How'd you get the cappuccino?
Stay curious. In Marvel's Avengers Age of Ultron, Earth's mightiest heroes battle the universe's most malicious machine, the baddest bits and bytes ever coded, artificial intelligence gone pure evil. Now recently, intellectual Avengers like Stephen Hawking and Elon Musk have warned that this could really happen.